Philippine bankers see continued growth in the industry in 2024 and 2025 despite macroeconomic challenges. That's according to the Philippine Central Bank's 2023 Banking Sector Outlook Survey, which showed 64.6% of respondent banks expected a stable banking system this year and next. Just over 70% of banks also projected double-digit growth in their assets. The results also point to improvement in banks' expectations on the quality of their loan portfolio. Fewer banks anticipate their non-performing loans ratio to go above 5%. The BSP interviewed 147 banks for the survey, which account for 97.7% of the total assets of the Philippine banking system. Of course, the results not surprising considering high interest rates benefited many of these banks. And now that interest rates are going down, economists and analysts looking at the sector say it doesn't matter because what the banks lose in terms of margin, they will gain back because of volumes. Because when borrowing costs go cheap, people will be more encouraged to take out those loans. So still, a win-win for these banks. The Philippine Investments Board says it's fast-tracking 126 projects worth 4.13 trillion pesos under its Green Lanes initiative. Breaking the numbers down, 3.7 trillion pesos of these investments are in RE, that's renewable energy, while 346 billion pesos will be in digital infrastructure. Around 29.6 billion pesos are in manufacturing and 4.14 would be in food security. Notable projects include three offshore floating wind farms representing over 600 billion pesos investment through a Filipino-Danish partnership under Buhawind Energy Philippines and the recently launched Kayanga Bugalyon solar power project in Pangasinan. The Green Lanes for big FDIs was launched in July last year to attract more capital to the country by improving the ease of doing business and expediting the approval of high-impact projects. Passengers from Manila can now fly directly to the scenic beaches of Busuanga in Colon, Palawan. This as boutique airline Sunlight Air says it will be operating its Manila-Busuanga route again exactly 1 month from now, that is starting October 27 from NAIA Terminal 2. The flights will be daily and nonstop. The airline transferred its hub from Manila to Clark in April. It currently operates flights from Clark to Busuanga as well as from Cebu to the Palawan Haven. Last year, the boutique airline CEO told ANC it hopes to break even by 2024 after being launched in 2020. From air to land transport, delivery platform Lalamove looking to provide jobs for jeepney drivers who may be displaced due to the government's public transport modernization program. The company on Thursday launched the metro leg of its Tuloy Biyahe program after its roadshow in northern and central Luzon last week with a turnout of about 2,000 aspiring partner drivers. Lalamove says it can provide car loans for drivers who don't have their own vehicle. They can also be matched with a Lalamove verified fleet operator who needs drivers for their registered vehicles. Aside from flexible working hours, the company is enticing these drivers by offering fuel discounts and free vehicle maintenance. Bad news for motorists. Oil prices are expected to go up come October due to an escalation of violence in the oil-rich Middle East. Diesel could see the biggest jump of as much as 90 centavos per liter. Gasoline and kerosene by as much as 60 centavos per liter. Other factors that are affecting pump prices include China's release of a stimulus package to boost their economy that could boost their demand and consumption of oil and the fluctuation in the United States' fuel inventory. The first driverless bus in the Philippines has started its initial operations at the New Clark City, but can it also run in Manila? Jackie Pascual takes a look.
New Clark City has recently launched a driverless bus under a demonstration program by Japanese firm ZenMov. The autonomous vehicle connects the different sports facilities at NCC and it is free of charge for now. The Basis Conversion and Development Authority says they want to make NCC a hub for sustainability as well as innovation.
While it promotes efficiency for transport operation, it also helps the sustainability ng ating New Clark City. Promote po yung aming vision as the smart and innovative city. It's a unique feature ho, and one of its one of a kind ho dito sa ating ating country.
This electric vehicle can sit about 10 passengers and it even has a ramp for persons with disability. For the trial period, there is a safety officer on board who uses a video game controller to manually move the bus in case of issues.
This is the first autonomous vehicle or driverless bus here in the Philippines in New Clark City. And as you can see inside, there is no driver's seat. And officials assure passengers that this bus is safe.
The bus is using Japanese technology with a smart mobility system, and it even slows down at pedestrian lanes.
The vehicle has several sensors, okay, several cameras, and those sensors are used to detect if there will be for 360 objects kung meron man. Nakaprograma na ang mga distances, locations where to stop for the unloading and unloading.
The vehicle stops to the when the sensors detect any danger, and then it stops. Whenever they detect any bars or like the branches, they just immediately stop, and then they just don't go anywhere which is not programmed.
For now, it caters to the employees and athletes at NCC, but anyone can ride the bus.
Maganda po ang idinudulot nito sa environment, sa ating kalikasan, dahil po nililessen niya ang carbon footprint.
Kampante naman tayo na kahit na walang driver sa area natin, lalo na ito sa vehicle natin, safe naman po siya.
Aside from the driverless bus, ZenMov also has other routes using electric vehicles, as only sustainable transport options are welcome at NCC. But is a driverless bus possible in Metro Manila?
I really don't know if we can quickly deploy that autonomous shuttle and our system to Manila. In the future, of course, we are hoping and we are wishing.
For now, officials are still finalizing the schedule of the autonomous vehicle, which is expected to be released in October. They also hope to deploy more driverless buses in the future if passenger demand increases. Jackie Pascual, ABS-CBN News.
Heads up, U.S. visa applicants, starting tomorrow, September 28, you will need to make two bookings for appointments to get your visa. The first appointment is for the submission of the application form and biometrics at the embassy's new visa application center located on the third floor of Parkal Building 8 in Panañaque City. The second appointment is for a visa interview at the U.S. Embassy in Ruas Boulevard, Manila. The embassy says it may sound like the process became harder, but the new facility is expected to process each visa application in under 10 minutes. It's also expected to handle an average traffic of 1,000 per day. For the VAC appointment, one will only need a printed copy of the appointment confirmation, the application form, a 2x2 photo, and the applicant's Philippine passport. The National Food Authority is seeking the release of 9 billion pesos this year for its PALE procurement efforts. NFA says this additional funding will bring its total budget to around 11 billion pesos, helping to meet its target of procuring between 6.4 million to 8.7 million bags of PALAI by the end of the year. So far, NFA has secured over 4 million bags. The NFA has been using an 8.7 billion peso budget carried over from last year to purchase palay from farmers this year. The NFA explains this would help support local farmers and stabilize prices for consumers. Agri-Secretary Francisco Tularel, who chairs the NFA Council, assuring farmers the agency will buy palay between 21 and 23 pesos per kilo. The NFA Council in June raised the ceiling price for palay purchases to 30 pesos a kilo from 23, while the floor price was lifted to 17 from 16 per kilo. A Philippine farmers group says local rice traders kept their prices high amid and made a windfall profit despite government orders to cut tariffs on imported rice. Jervis Manahan tells us more.
Rice retailers have already noted a slight downward trend in the price of rice recently. They say some suppliers from Bulacan have slashed prices by 50 to 70 pesos per sack.
After nung bumaba yung imported goods, sumunod naman yung mga local. Kasi dati mas mataas na yung local. So hindi na siya mabili yung mga local natin. Lahat puro imported. Tsaka isa pa kasi imported, mas maganda ang klase kumpara dun sa local.
Dati kasi nung...
The Federation of Free Farmers says the price drop is too small compared to the promise of the Executive Order 62 of 5 to 7 pesos per kilo. They allege importers have been pocketing the savings they get due to the tariff cut. Based on their computation, traders have already saved 5 billion pesos but they have yet to slash prices.
5 billion pesos na yan, yan po ay natipid ng ating mga importer pero hindi naman naipasa in the form of lower reduced rice prices by 70 pesos per kilo. Unfortunately, Yung inakala po ng ating economic managers na yung 6.70 or roughly 7 pesos per kilo na natipid ng importer in the form of reduced taxes, hindi naman po naipapasa sa ating mga consumer. So until now, nagdurusa po yung ating consumer dahil napakataas pa rin ang presyo po ng imported rice.
But the Department of Agriculture is unconvinced since rice supplies offered to consumers this month were bought from local farmers at elevated prices.
Ang equivalent na presyo niyan, 56. Hindi pa nauubos yan. So ang feeling ko naman, baka pababa na yung stocks niyan by October 15 of this year. And hopefully, tuloy-tuloy ng pababayan by January. At siguro makuha natin at least less 5 pesos.
Farmers, however, disagree, arguing that rice prices are expected to be cheaper in October because of higher supply due to the harvest season and not lower tariff. Palay prices have dropped to 14 pesos per kilo, causing concern among farmers. The National Food Authority asked the Department of Budget and Management to release the 9 billion peso fund for palay procurement to help stabilize palay prices. Jervis Manahan, ABS-CBN News.
It is going to be a wet weekend as a low pressure area last spotted east of Bataan has developed into a tropical depression. The State Weather Bureau Pagasa says Tropical Depression Julian is still hovering east of Bataan with winds of 55 kilometers per hour and gusts of up to 70 kilometers per hour. Pagasa expects it to enhance into a tropical storm by Friday night, that's tonight, or early tomorrow morning, and further strengthen into a severe tropical storm by Sunday. If you're in the Cagayan Valley, here's a heads up. Tropical cyclone wind signal number one could be hoisted there within the day. Well, for those in Aurora, Quezon, and the Bicol region, Pagasa warns Julian may bring strong to gale force gusts in your area tomorrow, Saturday.